at this point, since she's not here yet, and start filling in this background. One of the reasons that you want to start developing this at a relatively early stage, as I did around her head, is it begins to affect the values here, how you read these values. If this were white all the way up to the edge, everything would look a lot darker here. So I've got a middle tone value that I've built in. You can put anything in. But I was working basically off the value of that bulletin board over there. So I'm going to paint a little bit into her. Like whenever you're working your background, don't come right up to the edge of your figure and stop, because it'll look like you've cut out the figure and placed it on this background. Air wraps around the whole form. It's between you and me, it goes around you, it's behind you, and it changes all of the atmosphere changes the appearance of something. So I think I mentioned last week the possibility of actually just painting over the figure to get some of that atmosphere in it and then pulling some of the paint off. Did I talk about doing that?
No.
That would terrify you if I did it. But I might do it.
You mean a glaze?
Yeah, just a, I'll show you in a minute. I've done it before and it created a really atmospheric painting.
Couldn't you just paint a whole
layer? When you do things like that, you have to know what you're able to undo. It's kind of like working on your computer. If you know you can undo something, you have the courage to do it. So because this is dry, I can undo anything I do on this right now. What'd you say, Katie?
Oh, I'm sorry. Couldn't you just paint the whole background first and put the figure on it?
You can, yeah. I mean, sometimes it's really nice to work on a toned canvas. Because a lot of, with this kind of painting, you don't always cover up all the canvas. Hey, look who's here. And so that tone can come through. So you want to be aware of what kind of tone you're using. Like I like to use kind of a light middle range tone in ochre or maybe a Venetian red.
Did you say you can undo?
Yeah, I'll show you.
And you can wipe back to whatever's dry.
I'll show you in a second.
I'm not so much thinking of what she wears per se, but the reflection onto her face.
Yeah,
just a question.
That's a good, I hadn't noticed that yet. Yeah, if you look carefully, you can see much more blue right in here.
That's
a reflection from that. No, it's under the jaw.
Oh, under the jaw.
Yeah, and here. Although it was showing a little bit cooler, I think, last week. I'm not sure. The black might have reflected a cooler blue. Like, blacks will reflect blue. Like, if you look at her here, you'll see a lot of blue in it, in the reflected areas. So that may be where this came from, but because it's happening more today, I might change it or I might not. Mm-hmm. At some point, the painting really kind of takes over and it tells you what to do.
But you would be able to see that, but from me, and my eye is not as practiced as I did. So maybe
see what?
I will have, like, painting, and mix the painting of last week and this week, someone would say, well, that's good because she looks such...
Well, what you have to do, and this is where the practice comes in, is you have to pull it together. You have to make that painting work. Like when you walk out of here with your painting, the painting itself needs to work. The likeness, the exactly what we have there, doesn't have to work. But just the painting has to work. And so you learn to modify and modulate things in your painting so that as a whole it works. So if you start putting a lot of blue in here and you're, you know, working your whole painting and your painting looks, this is why it takes, I can't tell you how long this takes. So this is, because I'm answering these questions. So if you put that in here and you've developed your painting and everything's looking good, but you look at it, say you turn it upside down, and you look at it, and then I could actually paint that purple in for you. When you turn it upside down, you just see that like it's stuck on there like a postage stamp. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like so unrelated to the form.
Yeah.
Then that tells you, you know, we need to get rid of that.
Yeah.
What counts when you walk out is what's here.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's a little bit different from what I say to you when we're talking about drawing, because when you walk out of drawing class, it's what's here. You know, how you feel, what you connected with. You'll make those same connections with painting, but you know what you'll be showing is your painting, and it's just got to hold itself together. Like last week when I talked about these paintings that are 500 years old, it doesn't matter if it looks like the artist or his patron. You know, we may not know which is which, what the subject is. What matters is that painting has its energy and its strength and its power. And that's what we're looking at 500 years later, is the painting. So you just want your painting to work. And when you have questions about it, call me over. Okay, so I'll put that purple in real quick that we're talking about. Now, one thing about that purple, when you see it on her, is it's going to look a lot lighter to an unpracticed eye than it will, say, to my eye. Like, you may try to mix it as light as that blouse that Laura's wearing. If you may, because it's in the dark and you notice it, you're going to exaggerate how light it is. Because it's going to look really light because it's in a dark area. You know, you turn on a flashlight in a dark room, it's the brightest thing in the room, and you see it that light. So what you have to bear in mind is that it has to sit down in this value range. It has to be lighter than this value range, but it can't be this light. And you're going to tend to paint it this light, and that's one of the knowing things that you bring to your painting when you first start out, is that I'm probably going to try to make it this light because I see it so much. So I have to force myself to mix a darker value. So I tried to do that, and let's see if I did. I don't think I did. Had a lot of dog hair on the painting this week. No, that's pretty good. See how that sits down in that value range? And it also helps to pull the chin forward over the neck and in front of the hair. So this is an example, it just looks completely natural from back here. This is an example where there's a change that benefits us.
Yeah.
That's fun, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It kind of teaches you, painting kind of teaches you to accept things and see how to use them, like Kung Fu. She's taking Kung Fu now.
Oh, cool.
That Cheryl behind you has been taking Kung Fu. That's Jan.
You can hurt your wrist now.
Oh, good.
Yeah, you definitely can. They say the most dangerous thing is a white belt. You could hurt somebody's wrist. So, but if you zoom in on this, if you could, Katie, I'd love some close-ups today, too. If you want to come up close and look at this, it looks like it's just, you know, a stripe on there. But you stand back 10 feet.
When you were talking about it, how you would paint it, is that what they call temperature?
I don't know anything about that. That's that's a term I don't work with.
Okay.
Yeah. You have to just watch out for some of this terminology. I don't know about that, but what I do know is what I just told you, is it has to hold down in that range, and it's probably what they're talking about with temperature. See how it just looks like it's stuck on there?
Yeah.
But when you stand back, it merges, unless my eyesight's off. Oh God!
Because I like to get up. And
I get thrown out. I get it all the time. In Italy, they have these silent lights, and the alarms will go off. It's just horrible.
See that,
Sharon?
Uh-huh. I do see that.
Okay. I had a pair of pants like that in high school. I'm more close. I just okay. All right, so I'll continue working with the background. Oh, I know one thing I'm going to do for you, too. Now, I'm mixing a little different background color. I don't want a completely homogeneous background, because that's kind of dull. In fact, if you notice over here, I made it deliberately lighter. I'm reading off the values on the door now, rather than the bulletin board. Uh-huh.
There's an area that's bothering me in her neck.
Well,
I didn't recognize it until I was looking at a photograph yesterday. And when I stand back 10 feet, I see it. And when I sit up close, I don't see it as easily.
Well, what is it, Matt?
It's this point right here.
Uh-huh.
And how this relates to that.
Yeah. I'll tell you what I'll say to you about that, is that I saw that a lot when I was watching part of the video last night.
Uh-huh.
But it's in progress. you know, that's really all it is. I'm starting to lay things in, but just like over here, I moved the neck over this way last week. Everything is just like, it's like a kind of a jigsaw puzzle that's sure. kind of shuttering into place, and when it quits shuttering, hopefully everything will be interlocked.
Gotcha.
Yeah, but up close, you're right. It just kind of sits there and the values are okay. But when you look at it from a different perspective, like on film or from a distance, it might show up differently.
Yeah.
That's why I turn around my I turn my canvas over and I look at it in my studio in a mirror. So you need all of those devices to kind of help you out.
Mm-hmm.
I had to wash my sinuses out this morning, so I was starting to run a little bit. So you'll also see that I'm not using the same stroke everywhere. Like, if you use a completely vertical stroke or a completely horizontal stroke, it can become dull. And I'm not mixing a wad of paint and then using it all over. That would give me a homogeneous look. I know some people teach to mix up vast volumes of paint and just go back to them, but that's a little cookie cutter for me. And just like with this purple now, how that's been an improvement. Her clothes changing has actually is going to enhance the painting. Any changes I make in trying to continue to mix something relative to this can be an improvement, and I want to have that to take advantage of it. It's like in printmaking, you're only part of the process because the exposure and the inking and everything affects the ultimate image. Here, I don't want to have that much of an imprint on exactly what happens. I want some serendipity things to happen.
Will the purple make a difference in what you would use as a background color?
Probably not, but it's a nice, cool color. So it'll definitely affect what's going on around it, because some warmer colors will work really well with that. And I don't think too much in those terms. Like, I don't try to make my painting in relation to warm and cool. But just as that right there is plenty cool, it works really nicely. Like, see how beautiful that orange is next to that? It's very pleasing to our eye. So it's possible that I'll use more of that in here. Or I probably won't use it in here, but I may use more of it in here or leave that part alone. But it's not necessarily a conscious thought on my part. It's like, oh, when I have a place in painting or drawing that I just kind of go, oh, that feels so good. You know how your eyes can just kind of relax and blur a little bit sometimes when you look at something and it feels good? Then leave it. And basically, we're trying to build the painting so that throughout the painting, there are those places that feel really good. So some of your wisdom is in knowing what to leave alone. But, you know, you only get there by making mistakes and not leaving it alone and learning about it. Okay, so again, I'm painting into what I've got here. Before she sits, I may have to redo my paints. So. Did you guys work on anything during the week related to this class, related to the demo?
I wish.
You wish, yeah.
I worked on a picture of my dad that I started about 2.5 years ago.
Really?
Yeah.
Tell us about it.
Well, it's from a photograph. I blew the photograph up.
Mm-hmm. To a color or black and white?
It's color, but it's part. The sun has faded it so much.
Uh-huh, that it just reads mostly its values
yeah,
now.
That's good. It's lost a lot of its value. So
it's lost its color or its value?
Value and color.
Oh, mm-hmm.
But so I wasn't really sure about the value, but I thought, well, I'm just going to bring that out and look at it and see, you know, if I can make it better. And I started, I put one or two marks on it, and it just held my interest like it was on Friday morning.
Uh-huh.
And it was about 8 o'clock when I started that. And at 3 o'clock, I was still doing it.
Excellent, Will. You got some stamina there.
I forgot
there.
To eat.
Wow.
Yeah, it was amazing.
That's so much fun.
Jürgen used to say, painting is what made life, art is what made life bearable. Bearable.
Bearable.
No, not bearable.
I had all these plans and then,
that's wonderful when that happens.
Yeah, it was great.
That's really kind of the beauty of making art. And, you know, anything that you're really interested in, like if you're doing research or, you know, learning a language, if you're just really interested in it, you can...
just lose yourself.
Yeah. Lose yourself while connecting to yourself.
Connecting. I connected. What always gets me is that I connect to my dad so much when I try.
That's beautiful. Well, you know, if you want to work on that while you're in class instead of this, you're welcome to, and I'll help you. Absolutely.
Oh.
That goes for anybody.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome. No, you're here to work on something that's of interest to you, that means something to you, so we provide the model just because we do. Okay, so you can kind of see now I've got some space around her. So I'm going to do something that's going to probably scare everybody, because it's Halloween. And then we're going to take a little break because I'm going to have to recharge my paints. No, that's terrible. It's all dry. Okay. Now, y'all just hold on to your seats, okay? This is going to scare me, too. This is going to be like, man, I hope I can pull out of this. Okay, so I'm really getting a kind of a goopy glaze here. That's why I keep adding more medium to get it thinner and thinner.
Just to scare you.
Dry the paint for the eyes.
I can totally undo this.
And I'm just curious.
It is dry.
Is it still a little light?
Except for that purple. I'm hoping it's not going to pull off.
Too old, some of this.
Yeah. I mean, I might undo this painting, and if I do, then we'll go ahead and y'all just start painting.
So
unless you want to watch me completely pull out of this.
You want to blur it before you start bringing back.
What?
You want to blur it before you start bringing back.
No, what I'm doing is I'm just painting an olive glaze over all of this.
Does that have liquid in it?
It does. It has a lot. And I'm going to pull it off before it dries, believe me. But, all right, so let's see. This is really a daring thing for me to do. I haven't done this in a few years. This is how much I love you guys. I do this. Yeah. Kind of teaching artists is a little bit like doing this. It's a little bit of entertainment as well.
Yeah.
Like when I have to demo, that's why I always check in to see if you guys are enjoying it or if you want me to quit. Because, you know, it's like having an audience. Okay, so what I've done is I've basically put an atmosphere on her, with the exception of her hair, which I don't want to avoid. She's in a fog, yeah. Now, what this fog is going to do for her, hopefully, is it's going to create a lot of air between us and her. And that's a pretty mystical thing to create. When you can create space in a two-dimensional format, you've done something pretty special. And that's really what painting is about.
Well, now you've had a whole series.
Uh-huh.
Where the air is different.
Are you talking about his water lilies?
Or the ones in the Santa Barbara art museum where there's the
bridges. He was in the room and he painted the streets.
Oh, yeah. It was Notre Dame, wasn't it? Yeah, in different.
Yeah. And so what he changed was the air.
Okay, so Dana, where art thou? If you just sit up there for a second. Because I want to exactly see where the lights are. You see that? You saw this? Oh, sure. Yeah. You get a better picture without flash. Yeah, flash will reflect off of it.
Sure, the lens it doesn't look like you painted over faces. The face is still really clear.
That's digital. That's digital for you. Did you get it? Okay. Yeah.
And you can tell something with it. You can still see it.
Let me see it.
Look at that. Isn't that amazing?
Interesting.
I mean, you can't see it. But
that's
got
digital. My digital, and it changes my values a lot.
Yeah, this is less.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to look, when I look at her face, what I'm going to do by pulling this off is I'm going to be kind of pulling it off in the light, but I'm not going to pull it all off, okay?
Is that just a dry napkin?
No, it's got turpentine on it. I did this one time on a painting after being in, I came back, I'd worked on the painting for a couple of months, and then I went to Venice. I went to Italy and Spain for a month, but I spent a wonderful week in Venice. It was the most time I'd ever spent in Venice. And the, I forgot my books for you. I'm sorry. Remember I talked to you about Venice and the water and all of that. I came back, I was very frustrated with this little jewel of a painting on panel. And as I said, I was about two-thirds of the way through it, so I was about 2 months into it when I took this break. When I came back, I just felt something happened one day. I don't know if I was just not happy being back in Santa Barbara or what. But I was working on it, and I just felt very frustrated, and I mixed my glaze medium and my olive, and I knew I could take everything off. And you know how it's good to discharge your feelings if you know it's a safe place? And I just, like, with the olive, and I was like, oh, man, I better straighten that out right away. And it ended up really giving a lot of atmosphere to the painting. And It ended up being really one of my nicest paintings I'd ever done. It really feels a lot like Italy. You have to be careful. Now I'm starting to pull off last week's paint.
Oh.
So I'm also looking at the skull to get a sense of the orbits. I don't know, it's hard to say. That's kind of a relative term. It's probably thin for many people. It's not so thin for me. Like, I can go really thin. I can go where there's hardly any pigment suspended in the medium when I'm using my good medium. So, then when I come back into this, I'll come back and start enhancing the lights and it'll start popping more. But you may be wondering if I made a mistake.
Wondering if you think you made a mistake.
I'm wondering if maybe I made a mistake, but because I haven't done this with liquid before and I didn't do it on canvas. It's really different when you're working on panel because you have that really brilliant light underneath it. It's a precipitated chalk in rabbit skin glue, and it's sanded very smooth, and it's about 13 layers of that. It's a real old world process. I mean, you've got to have plenty of time and a client willing to pay plenty of money. I mean, I charge $25,000 for those paintings. No, it's about this size. But it's 3 months of my time. And yeah.
And you make your own
canvas. You thought I earned my living here. If I did, I'd be living in a garage. Yeah. I haven't gotten one of those commissions in a while, but, you know, I get them from time to time in, you know, groups, like family with two or three children. From 13 by 10, that's what size they are. That's the size of the Van Eyck painting that I told you
about.
So
you don't encourage to use big canvases?
No, I mean, I don't discourage it at all. If anything, I wouldn't advise you to use really small canvases because it can be harder to work small. Like if you don't have a strong facility with your brushes, if you're trying to work really small, everything's going to be right next to each other and you're not going to have any space. Okay. All right, so let's take
shots of cutting.
Thanks, Jean. You've always got my back. I like that.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, so you see how it's changed the tone, the color tone here, and it's actually closer to her tone. She's got olive skin. Basically, what I put over this was olive.
I was going to say, would you use the same olive or the same intensity of olive?
I would.
With
yeah.
Olive skin
tones? I would, yeah.
Would you ever use the olive tones to begin with?
Huh?
Rather than do a wash, would you, you know, paint with olive tones?
That's what I did, paint with olive to begin with.
Okay.
Yeah, because that's what I'm, all these darks in here are olive.
Okay.
Now, would you move this up just a foot?
I kind of wanted it right here. Could you, you can move it back a little bit if you want. Would that be?
Okay.
You can move it back.
That's fine.
You can move it back farther if it's in Polly's way. Is it in your way, Polly?
No.
Oh, okay.
You move back, it'll be right. That's all I'll see.
So you can see?
I can see.
Okay, so today our hair is a little different over here, and I like that. I'm going to take, this is a moment of taking advantage of that. And what I'm trying to do for you here is to draw out the shape of it rather than, you know, do a strand of hair, which I could do, but I don't want you to get in the habit of that. In the beginning, I want you to see the shape. See that shape against that shape? And then it subdivides into some light strands right into there. And I may not leave that, but right now I'm going to see how it works. It looks really dark because we've got olive everywhere else. So what I'm doing first is I'm going back into the hair, and I'm setting my values in the hair, and then I'm going to move in on the face. It's not a pattern that you have to follow. It's just what I want to do right now. Another time, I might do something different. Do y'all like this music today?
Using black alone, or is it mixed color?
Yeah, just straight black. But it's a pretty nice black. I've mixed it with blue and umber in this painting, too. Okay, now see how this doesn't look as strong now that I've put this in under it? So when you're painting, you always have, if something looks too overwhelming or too powerful, always pull back psychologically for a moment and see where else you see that value or that color. Go ahead and put it in, because they'll start playing off of each other. If I had put this in and thought, oh, you know, like when you're kind of new at painting or, you know, learning, well, we're always learning, but, you know, if you put it in and you panic because it feels too strong, you have to learn to pull back and see where else you're going to see that, because it's all going to relate to each other. They're all like little pieces of a jigsaw puzzle, really, that just are fitting in with each other. So this, to me, I don't know how it looks to you guys, but to me, this doesn't look so strong now that it's related on this side. Now, I'll come back and temper it some, but before I do that, I want to work on some other areas. I see a shape right in here. Yeah.
Did you choose olive wash because you wanted to...
It's because I have a lot of olive in her skin. Not that her skin is olive, but on the dark side of the figure, olive is the color that works best.
Not because of background.
Nothing to do with anything like that. It's just if I were painting you, the dark side of you would be olive.
Oh, okay.
If you go to a great museum and look at all the figure paintings, it's going to move slightly between olive and brown, always. That's just what works. Just go look at it. Look through a book if it's got good reproductions. I'll bring my books next week. I'm really
between olive and brown?
Yeah. Well, it depends on the art. Whoops. I see you guys are asking me too many questions. It's okay. Let's see what I just put black in there. Fine, I had. No, I was kidding. I want you to ask all the questions you have. I want you to ask questions without editing the questions. What was your question? What was your question?
Oh, it's missing.
So, Valerie, are you saying that no matter what the skin tone and the
just
the
about
subject,
it's going to be olive. Olive looks really, okay. Really well. Let's see, today there's a little bit of hair down here. Now, compositionally, I don't like that.
It's like
a Dutch girl? Yeah. I'm going to paint it out, but before I get involved with that, I'm going to continue doing what I'm doing. But already, I'm looking at it compositionally, which these are all the things that you have going on. You're like a scientist with a checklist going on over here while you're trying to tune all the controls.
What is it that you don't like?
I just don't like the composition of these two waves. This one got a little exaggerated.
You're talking about the hair.
Yeah. So do y'all like this music today?
No, it's fine.
Johnny Cash felt a little intense when I was watching the video. Johnny Cash. So one thing I want to go ahead and get though, because it's a massive black, because I'm working here, so I want to see. See, I'm drawing out the shape. It's darker right here than it is right here. These are the habits you need to get in. You'll see me when I'm demonstrating. Sometimes I'll just come and not quite draw out the shape. But the habit you have to get into is to see the shape. Because if you look carefully at her, and Kate, if you could zoom in on this region right here. If you look carefully right here, it's a little darker right here than it is right here. Do you see that? Mm-hmm. Come up close if you can't see it. I mean, y'all move around. This is your learning laboratory, so you move around as much as you need to. The reason it's different here in value than it is here is this is facing the light. This is part of the top of the clavicle and the muscles right in here. And this little part right here is changing plane and it's facing that way. So it's a little bit darker. But within this, there are folds that are picking up reflected light. And this is why it's really important to draw the shape. If you don't see this as a shape of value that differs from this shape of value, you're going to try to paint all these little folds in here. And you're going to paint them light, and you're going to get all mixed up. First thing you want to do is you want to assess something as a shape of value. Do you understand that? That was a really important lesson. And then that value continues on down here because it's, do you know why? Without me explaining to you, it continues on down here.
Reflected light.
Away from the light. Okay, say that louder now.
It's still away from the light, angled away.
It's turning away from the light. So this is her arm. This is the side of her arm that's turning toward that wall. And I'm seeing it just as a shape. Actually, there's a space in here where it's not that dark. And then over here, it's a little bit darker. So I'm going to go ahead and just kind of fill that in. The reason I'm doing all of this black is because all of this is going to affect the values in here. And because I washed out the depth of the black, I want to put it back in before I come in here and start changing things, because every value and every shape you have on your canvas or your drawing affects every other value. And they all need to relate to each other. So if I were to start coming in here right now and pulling up the lights and everything, her hair would, it wouldn't work because her hair would be very middle gray. Now that's one explanation. The other is that's just also what I felt like working on. Because I'm stepping back into the painting, I've done something major to it.
Okay.
I don't want to come in and start worrying about little details. So I'm worrying about big shapes and heavy values. It's easier for me. You know how when you're drawing, I always tell you if you want to make a correction here, don't come here. Start where you've got everything going on and find your way here. You know how I talked to you about that? Well, that's what I'm doing. So I'm kind of entering my painting in safe places. It's really safe to work the hair. It's really safe to work this. And then I'm going to come in where it's a little bit, you know, more, not treacherous, but a little bit more, I have to be more cautious. But it doesn't mean that you couldn't have just started right in here, because you could have. Right, Dana?
Right.
That's what I thought. Okay. Now see how just by putting that line on there, we've got more of a connection of her shoulder. Now the heights of things have changed now because she's got more bulk on her because she's, you know, carrying this scarf. So you see what I just did? I'm trying to find out where this side is, because this black scarf has volume and it wraps around her shoulders. So you see what I'm doing right here? Okay. This line, wherever this line starts, is about equal to where the chin is. If I found the highest point of where this scarf comes into her neck, and I have to imagine it through the hair there, but it's not too hard. Comes into right here, so I'm going to come right here and then draw it. Okay? Now that's a real fundamental lesson that I talked to you about too. Katie, you can move the tripod if you want to.
Well,
are you steady?
I'll do this for a bit and then I'll go back to the tripod.
Do whatever you want, but you can move the tripod.
This is better for some things and that's better for others.
Joan will accommodate you. Okay, so you see how I came here under the chin and then shot straight over here. And instead of getting real involved in these little like bumps and things, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go for the main shape right there. That's the main shape. You know, I talked to you about mass and then plane and then line. So here's the main shape. This comes down here. This bumps up a little bit. And then it comes down some. And then it flattens out. Now, these little changes in that scarf don't matter a whole lot, because I can tell you this. As soon as she changes position, it's going to alter. Like after we take a break and she comes back, this isn't going to be here anymore, most likely. So I'm not too worried about it. Now that value, excuse me. Poor Valerie, she shouldn't be here today.
Yeah.
She's such a devoted. So what I'm going to do, this value travels all the way over to here. I'm going to just fill that in, okay? Because that's in shadow. Now, it looks to me like it's too long, and of course it is. I was misled. See how this comes in right here to the neck? You see that?
Yeah.
Now, I went here and was using this as my guideline for the beginning of the scar. Now, that's a silly mistake for me to have made. So this line really belongs right here. Now, actually, even though that was an embarrassing mistake for me to make.
It's because you were sick.
Huh?
Because you were sick, not feeling well.
I know. That's true. But you can see how instead of trying to get all of the little nuances and bumps and planes in here,
and all of the little changes of value to show the folds, what I did was I drew the mass in. As soon as I drew the mass in, pretend this isn't here right now, as soon as I drew the mass in, I thought to myself, wow, that shoulder looks too broad. And so I came back and I reassessed, what did I miss? So the first shape I looked at was this shape right here. It's like, oh, that's the mass I missed. This starts right here. So now that I have it here, kaboom, 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 this comes to about right here. Now that takes about, where did I say it was, right? That may still be too big. I think it is. I think it's going to be about right here. So that's going to drive about 2 inches off the length of that shoulder. And I quickly assessed it because I put the mass in first. If I had spent, and this is why I'm telling you this, if this were your painting and you had, or I had spent a lot of time getting all of this, like, you know, getting really into the folds and everything, and I painted it and maybe spent 45 minutes on it, and then during break looked at it and thought, this doesn't look right. I, right in under 1 minute, was able to assess my size relationships and make the correction. And so I basically saved however much time I would have been spending on that. And that's why I urge you to do the same. Okay, so. I'm going to mix up that purple real quick. We're going to see how this is going to mix with the black. Well, actually, let me show you this. Anne, can you help Lawrence on the whichever? Anne likes to do this song because she's trying to work off a bad grade. So I have to kind of humor her. You can do it, Anne.
We're nervous.
That's okay. I know you can do it. Okay, so what I'm wanting to put on is this purple color and about this value, maybe a little darker. So instead of mixing this a little darker, I know that I'm going to be painting it on top of black. So the black will mix in and make it a little darker. But this black is very wet. So if I try to lay the purple in, well, I can do it because I'm pretty good. You know, I can't always do it, and it's going to be hard for you as a beginner. And you know, I say things like that, I'm pretty good. Well, you know, it's like almost 30 years of doing it. So what you can do, like if you have to come onto an area and you want it darker and it's got too much white, or you want to come into an area and make it lighter but it's got too much dark, take your palette knife, and this is a good one right here. See that?
Yeah.
Just scrape off your excess. You don't have to scrape off too much, but I'm going to scrape off the lot for you. Wipe it off of here. And you see I'm not being cautious, like coming right up to where I think it goes. Just scrape. Okay? I encourage you to feel free. Use this with confidence. Use your materials with confidence. So that was a good lesson for you to get right there. So I'm going to come here, boom. I'm just done checking my shapes, my legs. So I think actually that purple is right there. So now I don't have a lot of purple mixed up, but I think I have enough. I can paint right over that black. Bring it right down here. And it wouldn't hurt really for me to spend some time putting the purple in before I do a lot more, because this purple is so strong. That it's gonna affect the appearance of the worms up in here. Mm-hmm. Now when I look at that on, on the side facing the wall, it's darker. You see that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you see what I'm doing? I'm drawing out the shape, more or less. And I really emphasize the more or less, because it's always an approximation. Everything's an approximation until you're through. So I've got the dark side there, and it goes straight down here. Now I've got this kind of paint mixed up, so where else can I put it? It's always kind of an economy. Well, I see a little bit of bluish in here, so I'm going to do a little bit there. Now one thing that we're going to lose with what she's got on now is we're going to lose that elegant long neck. But that's the way it goes. That's all right. But no, what all I'm really saying about that is, you know, you have to assess, do we want that elegant long neck or do we want these colors? And there are ways it can be worked out. So this is an example of what was on here. It just wasn't working, but we tried. So you see, as I'm scraping this off, I'm scraping into the black, and when I come back into the skin, I'm getting black on there. These are the kind of things I don't want you to worry about, okay? Don't fret.
Even then, when the neck was wet, you couldn't really take it off.
It would be harder. It would definitely be harder. So let's go ahead and how are we going to take that off? How are we going to take the rest of it off? Remember?
Turpentine.
It's picking that up.
Wow.
So now I'm going to fold it.
Yeah.
I'm going to fold it that way.
That looks nice.
I may have to get turpentine from somebody when she's doing through.
I also want to see how you did it.
About how many days does it take for the painting to become dry enough to do that?
About 6 months. But to do this, if you have a light touch, you know, it depends on, you know, what you're... Faster, Ann. Somebody else had a question. Jen? Cheryl, you had a question?
I said I connect better, but I also wanted to see how you worked on that. And with the shawl on it, you couldn't see that.
Yeah. We may put the black one back on.
No.
Okay. We may leave. I may leave some of the purple in there.
Yeah,
I'm
a purple.
Jean, you're not even in this class.
Not as much.
Okay, so we've done a lot. We've got a lot on this
to get into your box.
I see. This all looks like this could be trouble, but. You know, like my attitude toward it, this is interesting. Yeah. Let's see how any of this works.
Because some of that color does reflect from the bottom up.
She's got some. She's got some cool colors in her skin too. Mm-hmm. So, like right in here. Okay. So while she's gone. I'm not going to work on her, but while she's gone, I can work on other things. One of the things I want to work on is this. See how white this shape looks?
Mm-hmm.
I've got a triangle here, I've got a triangle here, and I've got a triangle here, and basically a couple of triangles in here. So all of this, to me, is there's a lot of value change, there's a lot of shape that's drawing my eye. These are the things we talk about in critique. While I'm developing the painting, I don't want this influencing any of these other shapes because I'm not going to leave this white, and I'm not going to leave that. The shape may stay, I don't know, but I don't want to leave it white because I'm looking at it so much. It's going to draw my eye. So when you're in class or when you're working and you're working from a model, if the model leaves, don't work on the model, don't work on the figure. Work on something else if you're the type that can't take a break. And some people can't.
Are you going to cover a whole canvas with background or you leave it there?
No, I'm going to paint it. There'd be no reason to not have painting there.
You're mixing ochre and what's the other color, the darker color?
These colors are all different from anything that you'd be using. I can give you the names of it, but I can tell you too basically what they'd be called in your palette. Because these paints are completely different. These are like raw umber medium.
I can't even remember what it's called.
What is your idea of vignettes?
I don't like them.
What's a vignette?
So what do you mean by blurred around? Like
little cameos?
You mean like leaving a halo around it? Some
heavy tech.
You don't
want?
If it's something you like, then you need to go to a museum. You really need to go to find museums to cultivate the taste. I'm not saying you have to, but we as artists have to. And that's where...
I found the top that I wore last time.
Aren't we trying hard today?
Well, I found it in my car. Do you want me to put it on?
Yeah.
Okay.
See all the things you go through? You just have to ride with it. And everything that she's doing may not be making the painting better, but it's making the learning process for you. Because these are all the things that can happen.
In fact, we planned this.
Yeah, we planned this.
Just
Dana and I talked during the week to see how.
How can we throw him off a little bit?
Yeah, how can we throw Valerie off? So see how that changes.
Wow,
really?
I love
that.
From
the weekend, but I won't get close. Okay.
What did you say?
I quite like that.
Okay.
You like what?
The purple.
Yeah, I'm not painting over it yet.
This is great music.
Isn't it? It's Alicia Keys for Alicia Arajuja. My kung fu teacher plays beautiful music like this when I take my lessons from him.
Okay.
I have a kung fu mentor, and if you ever wanted to study martial art, that's an art.
I have been wanting to take kung fu for a
You've got to take this class. He's a dancer.
Really?
And he is a beautiful man. He has influenced my teaching a lot.
Oh my gosh. Wow.
Where are you teaching? It's at a private studio on Fairview Avenue on Monday nights. 6 to 7:30, it's $15 a class if you take sign up for 10. Or you can come and watch one class. It's
Right off Hollister?
Right past it's toward the mountains, past Cathedral Lakes.
Not behind the Enterprise
Now that is not the one that you were wearing last week, Amy. You know that, don't you?
It is.
Mm-hmm. You had a V-neck.
Yeah, I've never had a V-neck.
No?
See, this is where things come into conflict.
I don't know, actually own a V-neck.
I beg to differ.
She painted
a V-neck. No, it's really funny because I saw a V-neck was painted and I thought, I wonder why she painted a V-neck.
It was the way she
I think when you drop down, there. There it is. Get it on tape.
Here's the V-neck.
The nice thing about the V-neck is it creates it kind of pushes up this way.
Yeah.
A U is kind of, there's something about scoops in painting that, yeah, they don't work so well. So I'm glad we got that worked out for you.
Think of, well, it's visually, it's that planting of the head, the neck. Planted into the figure with a V-neck, isn't it?
Exactly. Okay, so see how we brought it back into...
So
whatever happens, happens.
But don't panic.
Just work with it. Don't panic. Is that what you said? Don't panic?
Yeah, don't panic.
Don't panic. Take it easy.
And that purple is so nice. Would you consider changing your background to have some of that purple?
No, I don't think so, but I might.
But in the shawl is nice, too.
Well, too many Indians. And I'm the chief when it comes to this place. On Monday mornings, that's it.
Aren't you gonna
I might leave this in. I'm just going
to
leave it
in. I like her other outfit. Put her necklace in and you get some copper. You know,
she could wear
earrings, too.
Yeah. See, this would
next week, I'll wear a bandana.
Purple bandana.
Next week, Dana won't come. So I'll get you.
This is where I'd be going nuts because you changed the shape of that to suit
was it a black shawl or something?
Yeah. Oh, that's now right. Going that's back. Right. So with see, that good I point. I need nuts. To change that. Yeah.
No,
good point.
But it looks like a cowl neck, doesn't it?
Yeah, no, we've got it. That's a good point. I'm glad you got that. Although I don't mind that.
I mean, she could put that back on, but if I were painting and things had changed that much, I would be having a hard time.
Yeah. Well, we're going to help you with that. Yeah, I'm going to have to really make a decision about that. I'm not going to worry about that. This is her actual neckline right now. Mm-hmm. And what it does, having it there, see how I'm not stopping here and going, I mean, I can do that, and I've done that, but I want to feel that neck coming this way. Okay, instead of poking around like that, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm just going to get rid of this and see how I like the composition without it. Without it right now because it's emphasizing this and it's pulling it forward.
You like turn of her head. I mean, I think it does accentuate that, which was part of what was so beautiful originally.
So we've done a lot of different things with this. One thing I want to get is I want to get this shape and then I want to come up into here. When I was watching the video, one of the things I realized that I don't think I've ever quite realized about my work is that I move around a lot in painting. Like, I don't just stay in one area. But it does, see how it what this does now is it gives us this curve, which is really more elegant.
Yeah. That almost looks transparent now. That looks pretty.
What looks transparent? Right.
Where the purple is. Where the purple is, it looks like there's, she might have another purple under that black.
And some of it will stay. And the black is not shades of gray. It'll have some cool blues in it too. Okay, so you see how I again drew out the shape of the black? Drew out the shape, and then I'm painting to fill it in. And when you paint an arm, if you want it to look dimensional, paint across it. Lead the eye around the arm, like if you're wrapping an ace bandage, wrap it around the arm, you don't wrap it down the arm. Yeah, this is a lot nicer. And then this is here. Okay, so I'm going to leave all this alone now for a little while because I want to get up into the head. So if this is going to change, this is going to change. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is I want to paint this out, and then I'm ready to come back in here. Does that make sense to you?
Mm-hmm. You're doing more sensuous.
You're doing more good.
Sorry.
It's all right. I want you guys to have everything you need from this. So. If you need to take pictures, if you want me to move to something else. Wow, that was a good match, wasn't it? So, Sophie, I was thinking about our keg party for you. Your citizenship. Yeah, remember we were talking about having a keg party?
Where you were.
To celebrate your American citizenship. And I think we should have it in class.
Keg.
Sophie became an American citizen. Well, she got her citizenship here.
When was it?
We were trying to think of it. Almost 17 years to the day. Was it your birthday?
It was the day of my birthday.
No kidding. October 9th is the anniversary of my arrival in Santa Barbara. For me. So I'm glad we're...
How many years ago?
17 years. Mm-hmm. It's been a hell of a ride. Okay. Here. All right, so let's get back into that base. Oops.
I need more.
I know, Anne. Yeah. I know you're going to be on edge until you get them, but you just have to be on edge for a while, okay? So that was an interesting ride on this piece, wasn't it? Let's go ahead and put the Gamsol in. Well, I'll tell you what I'd love for you to do is to dry out this. And just wipe this out so it's clean. All right. It's one of the first things I keep seeing is, see that strong light right there? That's one of the strongest lights on her face. And so when I get that light in, that's going to set the value range for my lights. That's going to be like the highest light. And I think that's why I keep looking at it. So I'm going to, guess I could get a smaller brush out.
Is that larger than a 4? Or is that
that's a 4.
It's so hard to find.
Oh man, nobody cleaned this last week. Trouble. All right, you're lucky now. I'm going to be able to give you the napkins. Uh-oh. You're going to really be worried.
Blue light is really good to clean brushes.
What is?
Blue light.
Mm-hmm. Blue light? Blue light. Wow. Where do you get blue light? Poor Sophie. You know it's all in love, don't you?
Do you have
I'll tell you, I've never used blue light, but I have a wonderful brush cleaner that... that we'll be able to reconstitute this brush. Thank you, Sonia.
What kind is it?
I don't know. I got it from this guy in New York. Mm-hmm. I get it from this guy in New York. Thank you. I think it's some blend that he makes. I'm starting to get a little paint on me.
It's so hard to find those brushes. If you are using the Richardson brush.
Yeah, you don't have to use them. There's another brush that's good, which is a Windsor Newton University flat.
Okay.
Which I use a lot, too.
Number 4?
No, I get a number 2 and a number 4. I've got a couple of them here. I'll show them to you when we take a break.
Good. A question about glazes again. Are there benefits of putting multiple glazes on?
Oh, yeah. You mean multiple kinds of glazes, or?
Well, I have. multiple kinds or multiple?
I wouldn't mix kinds, but this painting is a series of glazes. Now, one thing I noticed about the painting last week is she started looking a little older and a little fatter. Not Dana, but the painting. And I was trying to analyze what I did that caused that. Part of it was when I started rushing so I could finish it.
How do you make her older?
Well, this line right here, I mean, happens. She doesn't have it though. I painted it too dark. She's got, it's called the nasolabial fold, right? And as you age. See how that changes it?
Yeah.
Don't you wish? But I'm afraid I'm not going to be done today, and I just don't want to keep you guys from painting.
Demonstrate
I have been.
How many weeks have we got left? Do we
know? I think three.
Oh. What's your mixture that, I mean, in terms of, does that have some white in it? I guess that's my question. It's
yeah, it does.
Pure olive. Mm-hmm.
But you be very careful about ever mixing white into your olive right now. Because what it does is it makes it opaque rather than translucent.
She does look 10 years younger.
I wish I could.
Like a baby.
It's interesting, isn't it?
Sure.
And just lifting the corners a little bit, emphasize, I mean, you're going to have like some drop, even with babies, you're going to, you know, the fresh round skin, you're going to have a little bit of shadow here. As you age, you get more of it. But usually the lip will turn up a little bit, and you just, this is where I've learned from my portrait work, to emphasize the up rather than the down. If you want somebody to look really bleak, see how she's got a darker value coming down?
Mm-hmm.
I can emphasize it on both sides. Well, that didn't really do it.
That made it look a little bit more pensive when you
were there. Well, I'll say one thing to you about that. I see how that's kind of pulled her lip back and a little bit of a smirk, you know, like that. If you're ever doing this for people, I mean, it's just something I've had to accept. They don't want to see their children looking pensive, contemplative, or sad. Because those three things equal the same thing to them, which is, I'm a bad parent, my child's unhappy. And that's where I started, you know, really kind of assessing what I could do that would be true to the likeness, but to de-emphasize those aspects. So when you take pictures of people, you know, you'll want them like this, and you'll, you know, probably take about 300 of them to get the right one, and they're gonna look pensive because you're not taking snapshot, you know, like smile, look happy for the camera. You're not taking that kind of picture.
So have you had paintings rejected because
about $40,000 worth. I had a rough tumble for a few years. I lost about $40,000.
Was that the reason? Because
well, one of them, Sandra and I had a discussion about, was a woman that she just looked unhappy. They chose an unhappy picture. I should have stepped in and said, I don't think you want this picture. But while I was painting it, I realized I'm pretty intuitive. I was about two-thirds of the way through it, and I thought, they're not going to pay me for this. And they didn't. It was the first painting I'd ever had rejected.
But
and then I got real busy and got behind.
But it's stunning. The painting is stunning. And it's almost as if you can see into this woman's soul. And
you know what I painted along the top of that? It was a panel painting. Mm-hmm. I lettered in Spiritus to help her, because she seems so in need of spirit.
Mm-hmm. What did you letter in?
Spiritus.
Who was commissioning it? Her children?
Or her husband. I mean, he controlled everything. He was... Yeah, I mean, I could see, my view of that painting was, I can see what he's done to her. Of course, she was complicit in it.
That's why he didn't like.
She never saw the painting. In fact, I was living in Santa Fe at the time, and before I'd even seen them, I took the painting to get a frame for it. So I just knew they weren't going to pay me. And I walked through a gallery, and the gallery ended up, from that painting, wanting to handle my work. So I left the painting in the gallery, and I heard through, you know, you hear about it, somebody called her and said, your painting is in, you know, this gallery. And she came down the next day to see it.
Oh, really?
She hadn't seen it.
Mm-hmm. What did she
think? They never talked to me about it. The husband.
The husband rejected it.
Yeah.
Did she buy it?
No, they didn't pay me for it. That's what the whole discussion
was. Did the gallery pay?
No.
So you don't have a contract?
I didn't have a contract at that time, and I had always done my work on a handshake. I mean, it was just...
You still do?
No. Mm-hmm. I have a contract now. If I remember to use it.
That was 40,000 listens.
Well, that painting and a couple of them. I got behind in my work, and some clients got aggravated for waiting so long. But
are these going to be your lightest lights?
What? What?
Are those going to be your lightest lights?
They might be. I'll probably tone them down a little bit.
Do you ever send pictures, you know, towards the end?
I hate to do that, because then they will start micromanaging.
Yeah.
And if I'm sending, I had that happen this summer. I sent a digital, and my digital emphasizes dark and light. You know, that's just digital.
Yeah.
And I'd send it to her, and she'd say, make this a little lighter. And I realized what I was doing was I was working on the artwork in order for the digital image to look right to her. So what I do now is I send them a picture when it's done. And I mean, some artists have a policy that you get three, you know, like one or two changes, and then after that you have to pay for it. I don't feel like that's right when somebody's spending, you know, a minimum of $10,000. You know, they should get something they want. That meets my standards. If it does not meet my standards, then... One time I didn't sign something. I just sent it. I was real fed up with the person.
Because you made the changes.
She was micromanaging. It was a long story.
This picture you're painting now is going to
the
museum?
This one? I doubt it.
Is the self-portrait on your website the one that's in the
I think
museum?
It is. I think it is. I just did a lot of work on my website. Oh, you went on there?
Yeah.
It was kind of a dark umber around it?
Yeah, it looked like old masters kind of Renaissance.
You all right, Dana?
Yeah.
What would make a museum cool?
What?
Well, I just need to spend more time on it. The museum would have to run by it.
What will you do with this painting?
I don't know.
Sell it to Dana Scam for $10,000.
I doubt it. You all right, Dana?
Yeah, I don't know what. I'm busy and...
Are you hot?
No.
Okay. Getting a big psychic hit?
Yeah.
Really? Is it good or bad?
Great.
Really?
Yeah.
You want to tell us about it?
No.
Will you tell me later?
Yeah.
All right. Too bad, you guys.
Do you want the fan, Dana?
Well, Dana's real into it. I mean, Dana has real experiences with it.
Do you want the fan on you?
No, it's fine. It's fine.
It's not a physical thing.
It's not a... I'm not having a hot flash.
I thought she said you were getting dizzy.
No, it's not, but it's not a...
But it's nothing to worry about,
Shane. It's nothing to worry about.
she's getting dizzy,
we'll
but it's okay.
We'll pick you up when you fall over.
Are you pregnant?
I don't think so.
God, I'm almost ready to take a break, so you tell me what it is.
Oh. It's like I lost interest in
it. So you hear what you want.
What? Has to support it. You know, the skin has to feel like sometimes people say about my paintings, it's like the skin feels warm if you were to touch it. Mm. But the life is going to be, that's where the soul is. Painting looks bigger than her mouth.
Smaller.
Oh.
Is it?
I don't know. It might be. I mean.
I can see from this.
That's raw. I'll have to check the name of it.
Okay. Oh, you're ordering from them, Matt?
Am I what?
Is Matt going to order the time?
I don't know. Oh, she asked you a question.
Are you going to order those paints?
I want to know what colors she's using. Yeah.
But are you? Is it because you're going to order these? Or?
No, because I want to try using your palette to paint them. I already have them.
I know, Matt. Listen, yeah. Honey, we're friends.
Yeah, right?
I'm just teasing.
It's okay.
It's all right. This is kind of like a, you know, we develop a shell in here.
Okay. So. Would you mind naming the colors you use?
I wouldn't mind at all, but I'll have to check to see what they're called. I think it's called raw umber dark and raw umber medium, or raw olive dark and raw olive medium. That's why I haven't given you the name
yet. All right.
But I've got everything written down in there.
my black, and Mars black, in my paint box?
Well, just in general, for the more.
You know, and I can't. You know, that's a good question. I'll look that up. I've looked it up before. One of them is warmer. One of them is cooler. What I'm working with here is an ivory black, but it paints very according to manufacturer, just like clothes sizes do. And
but I assume there's some sort of principle.
You would, kind of like they have on Wall Street.
The lamp black, is it more of a charcoal? Is that a charcoal?
Well, as I said, I can't remember. It's been quite a number of years since I looked into that, but. If you have a tendency toward this kind of curiosity, there's a book that you should get. It's the Artist's Handbook by Ralph Mayer. And it will answer all, it's good to have in your studio, and it will answer all those questions.
Ralph Nader?
Yeah.
No, not Ralph Nader.
Yeah, he's a weekend painter. He's got tired of fighting evil. It's Ralph Mayer, M-A-Y-E-R. Of course, the guy I buy my paints from says that's a crock, everything he says. So,
really?
That's what he says.
He's opinionated.
He is opinionated. She's talked to him, too.
You have to be real careful with him.
Oh, did you offend him?
Oh, no, I make sure I don't offend him. Because he does not sell to people he gets annoyed with.
That's kind of a nice light right through there.
Subtle.
Yeah.
The question is, if Ralph Mayer's book is a crock, then who would he recommend to read to provide those kinds of that kind of information?
Hey, come on in. I still turn to Ralph Mayer. But he's partially true. It's probably partially true because, you know.
Yeah, but it's like, how do you, and where do you get?
Well, you just go to multiple sources, like any kind of study.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah,
where else would you go to get that kind of information?
Well, like the National Gallery Bulletin, Restorers Bulletin. I mean, you can start getting very technical, and I have some of that material at home, but. It just depends on, like, if you want to know the difference between ivory, Mars, and what was the other black we were talking about?
The lamp black.
Lamp black. The best thing you could do if you really want to know the difference is get those three paints and work with them, add white to them, add yellows to them, and see what happens to them, and answer the question for yourself. It'd be more hands-on. It'd be more informative for you, and you'd be making your own determination. And then know that if you buy it, there she is, Miss Dana, flying in from the roadways.
Flying in.
Whatever.
Crawling in on the freeway.
Well, I hope y'all enjoy my music I got for you. I stayed up late last night trying to get a nice soulful mix.
Will this paint dry at the same color that it looks like?
Yeah, I think it's doing pretty much that. Yeah. Do you need anything, Dana? Because I'm actually at this point filling in background, so if you want to take a couple of minutes to kind of shake off the freeway,
yeah.
Go get some tea. But only a couple of minutes, okay?
Oh, you can?
Yeah, I wrote something. Tea can happen.
Oh. Next week I'm going to Brazil, so.
Oh, are you?
Nice to meet you all.
So come
next
back.
Time.
Come back next time.
For sure.
Okay, Nadezhda.
I have myself.
Thank you. Okay, I will. Thank you for coming in. Have a safe trip and a lot of fun. Bring something back special. See that saint. Who's that guy? Dr. John or Saint John in Brazil?
Oh.
It's like when you go to America, be sure you do this.
Bye.
Did you need something?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is he in
the No, he's endowed with the healing
Qualities of God. That's what his website says. But he's kind of like, not St. Francis, but Father Pio. You know that guy in Pio,
Padre,
in Italy? Padre Pio.
What is it about this medium that you don't like, that you're not going to use it again?
I think it's toxic.
Okay.
And I think that also it has kind of a, it's not, you know, it's kind of a gut instinct I have about it mostly, but I don't think it comes up to the standards of the paint that I'm using.
Liquid?
Is that something you see or something you feel with
the
brush?
It's something I feel. It's just more, I don't really feel it so much with the brush. I just feel it like, you know, it's just kind of a
gut feeling.
Yeah, it's okay. Like something something they came up with and it sells and people use it just like acrylic canvases. Watch the...
Excuse me.
What do you think they'll switch to?
Well, I have a traditional medium that I mix, and I'll go back to it. I was just, you know, I like to experiment some, and the man who introduced me to these paints, would you turn the music down just a little bit? I asked him what he used as a medium, because I wasn't totally happy with the medium I had, and he said liquid, so I, you know, I thought, well, I'll try liquid.
So I was looking at
a little up, a little bit, just a touch.
Yeah.
I mean, liquid's fine, but as I said last week, it has a drying accelerant in it. I mean, that's one of the advantages of it. Like, if I have to get work, if I'm on a deadline, I've really got to get something done, and I'm working in oil. Liquin, you know, dries it overnight. And sometimes that's the case. You have to have it done that quickly so you can go back into it. And, you know, that's a value that it has, and so you want to know about that.
Why have you decided to make the background lighter on this side?
Because I was using the door as a value reference. Because I just didn't want a uniform background. And then when I saw it later, I kind of liked it. Does it bother you?
Well, just in reading about, because until now I've been self-taught, the light sources over on the right, and so it would reflect on the left side. It would be lighter on the left and darker on the right.
Except if she were casting a shadow, if something were right behind her, she'd be casting a shadow here, but traditionally, portrait artists will put light on the dark side and dark on the light side. I could have done it that way, I just didn't.
Well, that's why I was asking why.
Yeah. when I looked at this, I thought it worked just fine. If it didn't work, I would have changed it. Well, they can be a challenge, and I totally encourage you to work the background as you work the foreground, because if you get this foreground done, then you've got something you really like, you can say, oh my God, now what do I do? And I used to work that way, and I would panic and wonder, you know, how am I going to do this? So now I would just work the whole thing. And things happen, like, you know, sometimes you'll have a color you're using in here, and you'll, you know, just get an impulse to, you know, paint some over here, and, you know, you like it. But mostly when I changed the value on this side, what I was wanting was some relief from what I had there. I just didn't want a completely uniform background.
It's a great expression.
What's that?
It works.
It's pretty foundational, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, excuse me. Get back in here, Sophie. Mm-hmm. No respect. I just want to go ahead and get this filled in. Now you'll notice too, I'm not just painting up and down like this. Mm-hmm. I've got a lot of changes going on so that there's some movement back here. And that's important, even though the liquid is thinning it down so that I don't have any impasto, which is, you know, thickened paint. It's still important that, like, if you look through here, there are some changes. Some of them I don't want, but you see how I go horizontal and then vertical and then pull it horizontal again? And then some of it can go around, but you can see again, I'm not like here. I painted right on top of the hair and it broke up that passage a little bit, then I'll come back in and paint a little bit more black.
I don't know if you can see it from there, but there's something on here.
Okay, thank you. Okie dokie. Let's go, kid. Can we open the door again and get a little
the,
fresh air?
Medium that you customarily use, is that of a gel-like?
It's more liquid, and it doesn't dry as fast.
Yeah.
But it can be made to dry faster just by adding lead to it.
Lead?
Lead, liquid lead.
Liquid. Mm-hmm.
It's like, it's kind of amazing if artists get really depressed, the things that are in their studio.
Oh.
But I'm careful with it.
My head tilting to the right
of the... Ooh, that's really light. That's a little too light. But I'm going to go find some light passages through here. I don't want this neck to get too light, though, because I want the face to stand out. One thing that I thought really worked about doing that glaze over the whole figure was it gave it a unifying... it just kind of held the whole piece together in a way. And one of the things I noticed was that this was standing out in front of this, which is what I want. I want this to recede. And you can see how now that I start putting these lights in, it's like it's popping out, so. This is called Sinopia, this color.
Sinopia.
Mm-hmm. That one right there. It's a beautiful color. It's not a Venetian red, it's not... Come on up, you guys. You're well, listen, you get it. This is your class. Not you, Jean.
You're a brat.
I am a brat with you, it's true.
I think you dropped.
Tends to resemble magenta, doesn't it?
Yeah, but don't mistake it for that.
The touches of violet.
Where are they? Oh, right there?
Here, somewhere here.
Are you talking about that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just a little bit of violet.
Oh, good. I'll try to keep it then.
That's S-I-N or?
S-I-N-O-P-I-A, Sinopia. It's a great color, I use it a lot. And I never really used black very much until I bought this paint. I see that got too gold. But it might be a good undercolor, lightly. With your olive, you always want to balance it with red and yellow. That's why when you asked about buying an olive color, it's just flat. You know, that paint has, when you buy a tube paint, it has to be consistent throughout the tube. So you want to mix colors in it to give it vibration. So you want to add reds and yellows. So.
and spend plenty of time, all the time it takes to kind of get the color you need. I used to sit for my first teacher, and I was young and I'd get restless, and I'd watch him mixing color and I'd think, God, would you just put it on the canvas?
But you got to learn.
I learned a lot watching him mix color, you're right. He was a good man. He was a pianist. When we would take breaks, I would model for him in his house. And we would take breaks and he'd sit down at his grand piano and just play. He used to play for the Ballet Russe.
Wow.
Yeah, I think he developed carpal tunnel. I don't know if they knew if that's what it was at the time. And so his brother was a painter, so he took up painting. His name was Constantine. He was a good man. Mm-hmm. I met him in Atlanta, Georgia. And he and his brother and family fled Russia during the revolution. He was in his 80s when I met him. And I thought it was kind of interesting that they ended up in Atlanta, Georgia, from Georgia, Russia.
Yeah. Must be like,
oh,
it's called Georgia.
Yeah.
That's what people's stories
are. Yeah, he was in the Bahamas or Bermuda for a really long time. And he probably got on the plane to Georgia thinking. Maybe.
It's going east.
Yeah. And he went east, but not very far. Okay, so again, what I'm really blocking out in here, if you can get your mind to thinking this way, is if you look, I'm really blocking out shapes and values and trying to approximate the color. I'm trying to get as close as I can to what I want, but I don't do it. You know, it's like that's how painting is. You just keep doing it. So it's just really simple shapes, like kaboom, kaboom. This comes down here. This triangle here. Do you see these triangles?
Mm-hmm.
How simple it is? And now that I look at it more closely, this one has a leg that goes down that way. Instead of horizontal, it's at an angle. And again, I'm painting a little bit over the shirt so I can bring that shirt right back in on top of it. Can you all see okay today? Sure. The problem? Because I can move the easel a little bit. Okay, so now that I've got this big passage, I'm coming in. There's another smaller passage right here. You see that? So it's again just another shape, and a lot they often seem to be triangular. Here's one right here. I'll draw it out for you in Synopia. And the reason I'm using Synopia, like when you go to make drawing corrections or you're drawing on top of something, when you're working with skin, if you use a red, the red will fit in with your olive color. It's one of your colors. To mix the olive, in your palette you use viridian, cadmium yellow, and a red. So if I draw in red in an olive area, you can see how I can pull the red into that paint when I get the shape and I'm painting it. If I were to paint a brilliant yellow here, it would stand out an awful lot. But Constantine used to say it very simply, and say there's blood in the skin, so paint with red. So you see that shape now?
Mm-hmm.
You got that on there? That's how I see. Like when you see me up there painting and then things suddenly begin to have form, it's because I'm painting these shapes. Now at your stages, you need to draw out these shapes and then fill them in. What I'm doing during a lot of this painting is I'm painting these shapes, but I'm not drawing them out first because I already see them. But I drew them out for 15, 20 years before I could just see them. So don't bypass that stage.
Do you want to point them out on Dana?
Oh, sure.
Brilliant, Cheryl.
True videographer. It's right here. And then the baseline of the jaw is the horizontal above it that closes it.
And when you say that they tend to be triangles, is that just in this instance or in most cases?
I'm seeing a lot of triangles these days. I mean, just in a lot of what I paint, I'm just seeing it. But you just see it as whatever shape you see.
That's because you're talking about a round surface.
Yeah. Right. Well, I mean, I would expect that it would be most...
And here's one that's a little different.
I was just asking if she's seeing it just in this instance.
Here are a couple that are a little different there. See that one right there? And then here, this is, I think that is the terminus of the clavicle, right here, that little curve. You see that on there? Mm-hmm. Okay. So while I'm doing that, I'm going to go ahead and establish this line across here. That makes a difference. Boy, that makes a big difference for me to be able to see where that is. That adds a lot, doesn't it? Okay, so now that I've done that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to wipe as much of the red off my brush as I can. I'm going to come back into my paint that I think the paint color I was using over there for the background. It's a little light, but that's okay. You okay, Dana? You look a little tired. Or you're sighing a little bit like you're tired.
I'm not tired.
Were you coming down with something?
I don't think so.
Oh, okay. We'll get you done.
I just get settled, you know, you start to get settled.
Oh, okay.
Valerie, when you first started, did you do more measuring? Like you just started with the shape of the head? And
I didn't do a lot of measuring, but I did... In my mind, a lot of these shapes.
But I'm thinking about, you know, from the hair, top of the head to the chin. And
a lot of it I eyeballed.
Okay.
You don't want to get too caught up. You want to use your measuring when you need to measure something. But you don't want to get caught up in a measuring state of mind. Okay. Yeah. Use it when you need it. But only when you need it. Otherwise, it will become more of an engineered thing. Mm-hmm. Now, do you see how I raised this a little bit and cut this in a little bit this mm-hmm. way? That gave a nice feeling, huh?
That's pleasing.
Yeah, it is. I didn't know it would be, but it is.
You mean with your hair?
Yeah, right in here. I just painted the background in a little bit. Because before, this black came and joined really into this shirt, and it looked more like her shoulder was higher. So I'm going to go ahead and paint some of that shoulder in so it's firmer. So see where it's all black? I went back to that spot. I didn't mean to. I was mixing color for over here. I went right to that place you were talking to me about. So last night I dreamed that I was on a little ship for the for Antarctica. And there was a little dog that was out in the water, and I rescued him.
Good swimmer, Bill.
Well, I just had to reach off the boat. Nobody had seen him. I just reached off the boat down the stairs.
What kind of dog?
It's a little kind of a golden retriever type lab. And then he got on the boat and ran past me and went up to see the captain. And he was like, I'm back. What do you think that means?
It's very deep.
You don't feel appreciated, huh?
You know, perhaps that is it.
Well, after the risk you took?
I did just rescue, two dogs.
Oh, two dogs.
Well, I rescued another dog earlier in the year.
Rescue dogs are the best.
Have you been wanting to go to Antarctica?
Antarctica.
I've been wanting to travel.
I have friends who go everywhere on Asia, and that's one of their favorite trips.
Well, what is it? They're not artists, are they?
She is.
What is her husband?
She's an incredible photographer.
Engineer.
Yeah. I need an engineer. Yeah. And then I can make a trip, too.
Right.
Was the window open?
Huh?
Was the window open? Were you cold?
You know, it was a little port door. I was just kind of going by, and I saw this little dog out there doing this.
No, in reality,
no,
last
in
night.
In reality, were you chilling while you were sleeping?
I might have been. I had my fan on last night.
So did you reach out the porthole to rescue?
Why did I bring this up?
I know.
Yeah, I did reach out. I didn't really have to get wet.
You know, I have a friend that teaches English literature.
Mm-hmm. Should I call her?
And the way she finances her travel is she leads tours in England, literary tours.
Nice.
You lead art tours.
Mm-hmm. I'd love to.
In Italy.
Not to Antarctica.
Wouldn't that be cool?
Yeah, I would like, I had a set of students that were planning that trip one time, and then I just kind of backed out of it. We were getting it going. I'll tell you, I've taken friends over there before and really shown them things that they hadn't seen.
That would be great.
Yeah, let's get one together.
Let's do it.
When do you want to go?
You gave me an itinerary when I went to Italy.
Did I?
Yes, you did.
Did you follow it?
Of course.
Did you really?
Rome, Florence, Venice.
Well, you'd get that itinerary anywhere, Matt. But I told you where to go look at art, didn't
you? That's what I'm talking about.
You can do them.
And it really enhanced your trip,
oh,
right?
Yeah.
For less than the Santa Barbara Museum of Art, that would be great.
What'd you say, Laurel?
You can do them for new tours for less than the Santa Barbara Museum of Art tours.
Oh, of course. We'd be staying in different places than these people.
Fun, too.
It'd be a lot more fun.
The trouble is when you finally retire,
so you're looking
time,
forward to.
Your money all goes to your medical expenses.
Tell me about it. Yeah, I had to spend a lot of money in the last couple of weeks on that cough. Unexpectedly.
You see, that's what I always thought I'd do when I retired.
You just go ahead and do it.
Yeah.
I'm going to try to go to Italy this Christmas. If I don't just do that, I'm going to go before the year's up.
Go where?
Back to Italy. Yeah, I miss it too much.
The Pope's waiting for you.
Yeah, I wish he were. I mean, I could give him a good painting.
You could.
You can paint anywhere.
I've painted in Italy plenty. The thing is when you go there, and next week I promise I'll bring my books. When you go there, it just influences every part of you, and it just comes into your work.
Couldn't you make that a taxable?
Yeah. I deduct it.
Tax deduction?
Yeah.
Now they get you so much for luggage.
Well, you can go empty-handed.
Do you have to sell a painting that you made while you were there to make it?
I don't know. That's a good question. I should
ask that. Tax deductible?
Maybe she gets a commission from the Pope.
Yeah. Right. No, that would definitely be tax deductible.
Well, that would be tax-free because it's the Pope.
Yeah.
They don't pay any tax.
That would be a charitable contribution.
It would be a charitable contribution, which I could later sue them.
It would be charitable.
And I could go with you because I went to Catholic school.
You could be my...
Yeah, huh? I went to Catholic school, so I could do all the translating.
That entitles you to go with me, and you could be the official...
Videographer.
Videographer for the Pope.
Oh, my God. It's my new calling.
Well, does Santa Barbara City College have any programs in here where they have housing for students?
I wouldn't go through that.
They do.
Yeah.
I hate City College.
Okay, we edit.
Edit that. Yeah, you're going to have to come over and edit. Yeah, City College is really bad. I do not like it.
She's just kidding.
I can't tell you why.
There, John Hopkins was requested... a villa in Florence. And so...
To the students?
Yeah, the students. The university can send language and art students to Florence to study.
Which university?
Johns Hopkins.
Johns Hopkins. And it's just, I mean...
You've seen it?
I've never been there, but I... Good friend whose son-in-law is the chairman of...
Who would seriously be able to go?
Well, if I won the lottery, I'd seriously be able to go.
All right, let's eliminate Cheryl.
No, I'll borrow it.
I'll borrow it.
I just stop leaving my money at Home Depot. I might be able to save.
You know, if you just stay at home more, Cheryl.
Yeah.
But I have a friend whose son-in-law is the chairman.
My nephew calls. There's one over in the area of kind of the east west side of town of Atlanta. He calls it Homo Depot.
Edit.
Yeah, we're going to have to do a lot of editing today.
Yeah. It's a good one, though. I like that.
That was pretty funny. Uh-huh. It's too bad he's such a redneck.
Homo Depot.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's worth, you know. Well, you know.
The whole idea you said about the discretionary decisions you make, that was very informative to me.
Yeah, I don't make them verbally, but I do make them visually.
Yeah, that was...
Good. I don't even remember saying it, but I'm glad it was helpful to you. Yeah, you have to make choices, because what I said, you know, as you walk out with this painting's got to work. It doesn't. Nobody's going to say, yeah, but that was lighter on her. Mm-hmm. I saw it. Somebody might say it that way. They would say something like that. They're not going to do that. You just want it to be, in this case, you know, because of Dana's demeanor. Like, I want this to be as graceful and elegant as she is.
And soft, yeah.
Yeah.
She definitely is. You should paint her hands sometime.
Yeah.
Okay, I'd be happy to.
Her hands are lovely.
I have photos of those hands.
And maybe a lesson in hand painting.
Oh, you know, I could do a hand drawing for you, though. That wouldn't hurt for y'all to. Anything that you have difficulty with, you need to make really a strength. People have difficulty.
Well, I'm getting better on feet.
Are you? Were you? Yeah, because I did that.
Yeah, you did a class on that.
Mm-hmm.
So last week when you were sick, we practiced feet for a while.
Oh, did you?
Uh-huh.
How was the teacher? Who'd they get?
I can't think of her name.
Oki.
Artist.
Peggy Oki.
What was her name?
I think it was Peggy Oki.
Was it any good, or was it just... You want to talk about it?
Cheryl did a fabulous talk in that class.
Well, Cheryl's a genius.
And a videographer.
You're
I should have been a geek, but I wasn't.
You should have been a geek?
In-gate.
In-gate?
In-gate.
Gate.
Oh, gate. That's a California thing. Yeah. You know, they didn't have that in Georgia.
Did I am any less of a person?
We did not have gates. They kept us all back.
They kept me.
They had a lot of gates,
the gate.
Not the same kind of gate.
Did you grow up in Atlanta or?
No, I grew up in Washington D.C. That's why I became a painter, I think.
Became what?
A painter.
You just got to go to the art museums.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
Now, I don't like this and that.
What don't you like about it?
They just, compositionally, they don't work. So I'm going to take that right back out. So let's get back to Italy.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Sophie's going to sponsor us this summer. I'm going to come see you this summer, Sophie, if that's still... Are you here?
Mm-hmm. She's not talking.
Yeah, I noticed.
Are you going to be at home?
Mm-hmm. Mm. Can we have your address?
Yeah. Do you live in
just
the city?
I don't know if she lives close to a bakery.
Ooh. Yeah. A patisserie.
That issue of the hair at the shoulder, would you call that an issue of design?
I guess. Mm-hmm. Composition.
Composition.
I kind of try to keep, you know, like my vocabulary about painting specifically kind of simple. Like somebody asked about temperature. Well, you know, it's like you can kind of start getting into a lot of words. Really, it all comes down to, does it work?
Mm-hmm.
What didn't you like about the shoulders? With two definite lines on the left and the right, is that what you were talking about?
No, just now?
No, that's not about the hair.
No, I'm talking to Valerie.
I had the hair, her hair is going this way.
Yeah.
And I had this hair going this way.
Mm-hmm.
It actually looks nice on her, but I kind of like not having a lot of that because it makes the neck longer.
Mm-hmm.
And also I had, when this one was going this way, it was echoed almost exactly by
that's
this.
What I mean,
and it felt, yeah, it just felt like it was flattening it out, like it wasn't.
What makes the neck longer, having the hair?
I think not having it.
Mm-hmm.